Good morning. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Kim, one of the pastors here at MPC, and we're going to have our Bible reading this morning, and it's Ephesians chapter 5, and we're starting from verse 21. Now, it is page 1176 in your church Bibles, 1176. Now, as you look at that, some of you are probably thinking, but we had that passage 2 weeks ago. And you would be right in thinking that we most certainly did. Now, what we've been doing in our Ephesians series, and this is the last one of that series, we have been going back into some of the passages a second time and having a look at them from a different angle. And we'll be doing that this morning. So a couple of weeks ago, you would remember that Phil did an excellent message on submission and love in marriage. And today we're going to have a look at the passage, looking at it from the topic, change in yourself. So let's have a read of it now, reading from verse 21 of chapter 5. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Saviour. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church, without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In this same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated their own body, but they feed and care for their body, just as Christ does the church, for we are members of his body. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I'm talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you must also love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honour your father and mother, which is the first commandment, with a promise, so that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on the earth. Fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. Slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear and with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. Obey them not only to win their favour when their eye is on you, but as slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart. Serve wholeheartedly, as if you were serving the Lord, not people, because you know that the Lord will reward each one for whatever good they do, whether they are slave or free. And masters, treat your slaves in the same way. Do not threaten them, since you know that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven, and there is no favouritism with him. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we look to your word today, we pray that you would guide and lead us and give us understanding, and that we might be encouraged to grow and to change and to develop in the way that you desire for our life. So we commit our ways to you and give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, last year and this year, I've been doing a few subjects at Queensland Theological College, and I've found it's absolutely great there. The support staff are just brilliant. They support, they encourage, they're as helpful as they possibly can be. And then, of course, the lecturing staff do an amazing job. They write up just a whole array of notes for us, and then they teach us. So there's a lot of teaching and lots of input. However, I found that to pass each subject, you have to do assignment work as well. And what I've found is that it's all well and good to have support from other people. It's all great to have teaching, but at the end of the day, you have to have the desire to pass and you have to make the effort. You have to put the effort in. You know, you can sit down at your laptop and you can have all your textbooks there ready, and then you can look at your blank screen. But for all the support I've had, for all the encouragement and for all the teaching, unless I actually do something myself, not one line is going to appear on the blank page on my laptop. So at the end of the day, you just have to get in there and do it yourself. Now, our Christian walk is so similar to that. There are people around us who encourage us. There are people around us who support us. There is lots of good teaching that happens every week through Sundays and growth groups and children's church and youth and so on. But at the end of the day, regardless of all of that encouragement and all of that teaching, we still need to have the desire in our life that we want to change. Change for the better. That we want to progress and to become more and more the people that God wants us to be. Now, as followers of Jesus, God is making us more like Jesus every day. That is what God is trying to do in our life. He's trying to develop our character as we see described in the fruit of the Holy Spirit. So we're going to have a look at that up on the screen now. So in Galatians chapter 5, it says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control." Now, note that the Bible talks about fruit, not individual fruits. And that's because God is trying to develop the whole package. And this requires change, unless, of course, we are already perfect. Now, if you're already perfect in Christian character, you can switch off now. You don't even need to listen anymore. But just in case you feel that you can still develop in Christian character, then today is an important message for us. Now, through God's grace, we are saved in Christ Jesus. But that's only the starting place. Then God works in us for our development and our growth. And that, of course, is God's part. It's a very important part. Without God working in us, we wouldn't have a hope of changing ourselves. But God then requires us to play our part. Or in other words, he wants us to come to the party, as we say. And this requires action on our part. Now, today's passage is full of action. It's full of action words. And if I remember my teaching well from school days, action words are verbs or doing words, I remember we were taught. I'm sure all the teachers are going to be so happy with me today. Now, let's have a look at some of these words that appear in the passage. So the things that appear in the passage, we could describe them as verbs or action words or doing words. So the passage calls us to submit, to love, to respect, to obey, to honour, to train, to instruct, and to serve. Now, for us to change, for us to develop in our Christian life, we need to do things, we need to act. When God says in his word, "I want you to do all of these things," then we need to take it seriously and we need to say, "Right, God, I am going to make an effort with your help to do exactly these things." Now, who's seen the Subaru ad on TV of late? I'll pop it up on the screen and that might remind you about it. Remember the ad where the guy's sitting on the couch doing not much at all, just watching TV lazily, and his three dogs come in and start singing that song. It's only got one word in it, do. I'm not going to sing it for you. You'll all rush out of church singing He's Terrible. But they just sing that one song, Do. And then, of course, they get taken in the car off to the beach, and the next minute you see the dogs racing up the beach and they're doing something. They're active. They're really happy. And then the series of ads changed and you had G.I. Joe, and there he is pictured there. He's one of those action dolls. And you see him up on the mantelpiece, and he's in his packet, and he starts to sing Do. And he's singing that song, so they put him in the Subaru and take him out, and you see him doing all these action adventures. Now, God wants us to be active. He wants us to be proactive in our Christian walk, not to be passive. He wants us to be G.I. Joe out of the packet. He doesn't just want us to look like nice Christians, all wrapped up in the packet, not doing anything. He actually wants us as Christians to be out of the packet and to be action people and doing the very things that he puts here in his word. Now, some Christians think that if they stay at home and do nothing but not harm anyone, then they are exercising Christian love. They might think things like, if I'm not nasty to anyone, then I'm a pretty good person and I am showing God's love. I'm not like those nasty people out there. I'm just minding my own business and not hurting anyone, and I'm a loving person. That is a passive stance. It's not a proactive stance, and it is not actually God's love. God shows his love for us in a very active way. So while we were sinners, God loved us. Jesus died for us and he rose again to life. He sits at the right hand of the Father interceding for us. Through the Holy Spirit, God continually reaches out to us and he actively loves us and he's working on changing us. God is very active in his love. And then Jesus taught us to be proactive in God's love, not to be passive. And we're going to have a look at Luke chapter 6, verse 31, where Jesus taught about love. And he says this, do to others as you would have them do to you. So that's a proactive stand on love. Jesus doesn't say to us, hey, just don't harm anyone. That's a passive stance. He actually says, do to others as you would have them do to you. And that might go for a whole lot of things. So, for instance, I've just pulled out a few examples. But we might think, I want people to speak to me on Sunday at church and to be understanding of me. Well, if that's what we want for ourselves, then we should be doing that for other people. We might come and think, I like receiving morning tea. It's great going out there and having all of that food. But Christian love would then turn that around and say, well, if I like to receive when I have opportunity, I'm going to do that for other people. We might think, like, I love having the kids taught at church. That's just not parents. I think all of us love having the kids taught at church. We like being that kind of a church. But God's love will turn that around and say, hey, well, as you are able, you take a turn at teaching the kids. And we could go on and on and on. And the point isn't that we have to do everything all of the time. We can't. That's impossible. You can't do that. It's not what God expects. But the point is that God wants us to be more than passive. He wants us to be proactive. So whenever we can, in whatever way we can, then God wants us to be doing the Christian life. So let's have a look again at these words. Submit, love, respect, obey, honour, train, instruct, and serve. They are definitely doing words. Now, in this passage that we read today, there is instruction to husbands and wives, and to parents and children. Now, may I just address the younger ones who are here today. Our children and our teenagers, I know you're probably few in number, but I think it's very important that we have a look at what this passage might be saying to our younger people, because often we overlook the fact that God is speaking very much to our children and to our teenagers. And the fact that God is mentioning them in this passage is an expectation from God that our children and our teenagers are also doing or also active in the Christian life. And young people here today, you know as well as I do that being a Christian is not just about what we can get out of it, but what we put into it. But the strange thing is, the more you put into it, the more you get out of it. Now, young people, listen, in this passage it says this. It says, obey and honour your parents. Okay, that's really important. But can I say a few more things to you? Don't just come to church because your mum and dad say you should come to church, but make your own decision to follow Jesus. Work with God as he brings change to your life because he wants to use you. You've probably heard adults say to you as young people that young people are the church of tomorrow. Well, I believe that young people are the church of today because you can serve God and you can make a difference today. It's no good as young people waiting till you grow up and then trying to reach out to your young friends. It's too late. If you've got people around you at school or in your family who don't know Jesus, then God wants to use you to share Jesus with them. It's no good waiting till you've grown up. God wants to use you right now. And I think that's really exciting. Young people, you're not just there on hold waiting till you grow up and then suddenly one day you'll serve God. God wants to work with you right now. Now, I'm just going to share a few things because you're probably looking at me thinking, oh, he's pretty old. Well, I was young once, and I'm just going to share a little bit about when I was a teenager. As a teenager, every day I made sure that I read the Bible. I just made sure that I read a passage because I thought God wanted to talk to me through his word. And I remember I had a favourite book that I used to read and it said, read this passage, and then it told you a bit about it. I used to read the Scripture Union notes and I used to just love reading God's word. I used to go to church twice on a Sunday. And when I was at church, I sang and I listened to everything that happened. And I'll tell you what, it was a chore in my day because we sang these hymns that were written back in the 1600s. And oh boy, they were hard to sing. But I just believed that we should be there singing to God. Hey, but guess what? They revised the hymnal and modernised it. They put out a new one and then all the hymns were written in the 1800s. Wow, it was so modern. But young people, come to church and sing and join in because you're actually singing to God and he loves to hear you sing. I used to go to youth group and I would not miss anything the youth group did. I'd be at everything that the youth group did. And as soon as I was old enough, I became a youth group leader. I used to be involved in the evangelism program of the church. And sometimes we went out knocking on doors just in the community. As a teenager, I was there. We used to go out and visit some of the people that had been in church once, but they'd left church. And so as a teenager, I'd go out with an older person and I'd find myself in the home of all these adult people telling them why they should follow Jesus and come to church. We used to, as teenagers, go down into town, and at that stage there was a cult that used to get out on the streets called the Children of God, and we used to go down and debate with them and argue about Christianity with them. When I was old enough, and I think I was probably too young, but I worked with Lifeline and was a counsellor on the phone for a couple of times a week. Why I'm saying this to you as young people is that I went hard after God as a young person. And the more I did, the more God grew me and changed me and developed me. So young people, I just want to encourage you today to really go for it in God, to be a follower of Jesus yourself, because God wants to work with you. He's not waiting till you grow up someday and become an adult. He wants to work right with you now. You are important and you are precious to Him. And can I just say this to everyone? You know, in Christianity, let's plunge in. Let's not just dabble around the edges. You know, you've probably heard sometimes people say, oh, this Christian life, it's boring, or, oh, I can't really get into it. It doesn't do anything for me. The only time that happens is when we dabble in it. But when we plunge in and we actually say, I'm going to do the doing words, I'm going to do the action, then we find it makes a huge difference in our life. I remember on a church picnic once, we went out and we played cricket. It was next to a river. And it was one of those really hot days. It was in the mid-30s and it was just so hot. And after playing cricket, I went and put my toe in the water or my foot to see how cold the water was. And it was cold, but I thought, I'm going to plunge in. You know, when I plunged in, I was refreshed and I was energised and I was ready to go. But if I'd only just stuck my toe in the water, it wouldn't have had any benefit for me at all. You know, I sometimes see that people just approach Christianity and they just sort of stick their toe in and they dabble a bit around the edges and they might read the Bible once or twice a year and then they wonder why nothing's happening in their life. But if you plunge in, if you really go hard after God, if you allow God to work in your life and you read the Bible for yourself and you're really there determined to do the action words, then the Christian life becomes so exciting. It becomes challenging. There is never a boring moment. Now, in Ephesians 5:21, it says, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Now, submission to one another is based upon our reverence to Christ. And we revere Christ when we are submitted to God. And change in ourselves comes through being submitted to God and to each other. It is an attitude by which we live our life. Now, I'm popping up an illustration here on the screen. It's a bit of a funny illustration that I found on the internet. And it's usually used to talk about teamwork between people. And teamwork requires submission. We can't pull our own way and expect to have healthy results. And when people pull against God or away from God, they won't have Christian change. And that's the whole problem for humanity that the Bible talks about, that separates us from God. It's when people say, I will do it my way, and they pull away from God or they pull against God. But as Jesus followers, God wants us to stop being stubborn and to submit to Him and to each other. And this brings the change. It grows us. It brings about healthy results. And therefore, we need to hear God speaking to us. Now have a look at this picture. It just says a whole lot. Because God speaks to us as the Holy Spirit gives us revelation and understanding of the Bible. When we listen to the sermon on a Sunday, are we listening to the changes God is wanting in our lives? Or are we thinking like this? Have you ever done this where you're sitting there listening to the sermon and you're thinking, oh, I wish Joe Bloggs was listening to this sermon today. If he listened, he'd change. It would do good for him. Or are we listening to the Bible for ourselves? Because first and foremost, we should be listening to the sermon, we should be listening to the teaching, wondering, God, what do you want me to do in my Christian walk? What are the action words that you want me to be getting going in my life? You know, I've read some surveys in the USA that are really disturbing, because they've shown that some ministers read the Bible in order to teach others, but that's the only reading that they do. But ministers must also read the Bible to hear God speak to them for their own change. I love to read the Bible in order to teach, but I also read the Bible regularly, saying to God, God, what change do you want in my life? What growth do you want in my life? What do you want me to do in my life? You know, I've been listening to a bit of that Royal Commission into child abuse, and I have just been so disturbed. And I think, how can those ministers do the harm that they do? I'm just staggered. I cannot believe it. And I think that in some way they must have been teaching the Bible in some fashion. I'd hate to think what they were teaching out of the Bible, but in some fashion they were teaching the Bible, yet obviously they weren't reading the Bible for themselves, allowing God to speak into their life. Because if they were, then they would be living a life that was doing good to others, not bringing harm. Now for us, we need to be determined that we read the Bible, that we listen to all the teaching, first and foremost. God, what are you trying to do in my life? What do you want me to do? How do you want me to grow and to develop? Now, just in coming to a close, we've got to finish shortly and bring the kids in, but can I just throw in a couple of pastoral comments here? Now, because the passage speaks to husbands and wives, I'll just throw this in. This is just more a pastoral comment. Phil said last week that we'll throw in a couple of pastoral comments just to wrap up this series on Ephesians. Husbands and wives should encourage and support each other in their Christian growth, but we must understand that our marriage partner is not God and never replaces God. If we want to change, if we want to grow, we need to go to God. Your partner can't heal your past. Your partner can't erase your wrongs. Your partner can't make you holy. Your marriage partner is there to help, but God is the sanctifier, the one who sets you apart to himself and grows in you the fruit of the Holy Spirit. And that's why it is the fruit of the Holy Spirit. It is not the fruit of your husband or your wife. Do not put on your partner or expect of your partner that which is the role of God. It will put a strain on your marriage that it was never designed for. And the last comment, and I'll say this really sensitively because I know that people have been through a lot in life, but don't use the hurts or the failings of the past to stop you changing. God's grace is at work in you. He's on your side. God is at work to make you more like Jesus. And that's a very good thing, because we can't do it on our own. But when we've got Jesus on our side and he's working on it, then that becomes something that is so possible. Regardless of your past, God wants a new and changing future for you. So we'll close just with these passages because they are so encouraging for us. Romans 8, we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. What an encouraging thing that might be, or it is for us. And regardless of what we've been through in life, and regardless of how tough it is, be encouraged today that this change is not happening just through you doing it yourself, but God is at work in your life. And then Philippians 2, for it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that as we are changing and becoming more like Jesus, that we're not just doing it ourselves. We're not just doing it through sheer human effort, but we are doing it hand in hand with you as we submit to you, as we allow you to work in our life. Then, Lord, you bring about that change and you enable us to do the doing words, to do the action words, to fulfill the instructions and the teachings that you bring to us in your word. So, Lord, we are encouraged by this. And I pray, Lord, that if anyone is here and they're hurting today, if they're struggling, if they just think, hey, life is just so hard, I pray, Lord, that they might be encouraged and built up and lifted up, and that with renewed hope that they would look to you and realise that you are mightily at work in their life to bring about these changes. They're not in it on their own, but they have your help every step of the way. And Lord, we thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.